What's going on there in Detroit? Is the great Detroit Renaissance underway? Is this for real? Well, come on, don't fool me. I don't believe that things either are terrible or great. I believe, you know, if things get better in a place like Detroit, they get better slowly.
Right. Yeah, well, glad to be here. What you said is exactly true. It would be hard for them to be worse, right, than it was a couple years ago. So it would be almost impossible to come here and say Detroit's no better. There's dramatic changes, you know. Thousands and thousands of people are getting their jobs back. The cars are better. I mean, you've seen it. You've seen the stories. But certainly there's a lot of work to be done. And there's a lot of things that were not fixed in the bankruptcy and in the bailout. And we're really seeing that now.
Right. So let's go back a couple of years. Let's put on our time machine, you know, the dream sequence for the movie. Ooh, we're going back 2 years. The two things that were talked about all the time during the bankruptcy, one was Opel and the problems GM was having in Europe. And second was the future of electric cars and the future of the Chevy Volt. Right. And neither of those things have been fixed.
No, I mean, they have not been working out well, particularly for General Motors. The bankruptcy was a U.S. bankruptcy. It fixed a whole lot in the U.S. Anyone who's familiar with GM knows that the story used to be that GM lost a ton of money in the United States and was succeeding elsewhere around the globe, with the exception of China. Almost the opposite is true today. They're making buckets of money
In the
U.S. and in North America, and they're not looking so well elsewhere.
What are they looking to do in terms of restructuring Opel, which is their European division?
Well, a huge focus is shutting down some plants there. There's overcapacity. The market's not expected to grow. It's shrunk. There's more competition. And, of course, it's been very, very difficult for all automakers to do. But it would be, it wouldn't be fair to say their only problem there is just that they have too many workers and plants. I mean, their cars are struggling in the marketplace. Opel's not the most popular brand there. They have a lot of image issues there. So they're working on that, too.
Because they were thinking, in fact, of shutting down or selling the division a few years back if they could have found a buyer for it. They decided not to do that, and Lord knows shutting down plants and firing people in Germany is very, very difficult.
Yeah, it's not popular. Yeah. When you have a brand that already has a damaged image, first you try to sell it, and then you're in the middle of labor stuff, so it's really not helping them.
So let's turn to the problem here in the U.S., which it shouldn't be that big a deal, but for political reasons, this Chevy Volt has become a lightning rod for both for politics and also as an image problem for GM in the U.S. They're spending a lot of money on ads, I noticed. It's like a Chevy Volt ad every 15 minutes. There are more Chevy Volt ads on TV I've seen than cars have actually been sold in the last few months.
Well, yeah, and if you're GM, you don't want to be out advertising the Chevy Volt. I mean, how many Corvette ads do you see on TV?
Why? What's with all those ads?
Well, I mean, they've put a tremendous amount of money behind this car, and they've staked their reputation on it, and not necessarily the current leaders at GM. I mean, this goes back, this goes back 4 or 5 years. So to have this car flop for them would be a pretty big disaster. It would be, bad image-wise. It would be not great for the investment. And, they have a lot of image damage to undo right now.
But when do you stop throwing good money after bad? And by that, I mean, Toyota just launched a new version of the Prius, which is far outselling both Nissan's Leaf as well as the Chevy Volt. I mean, if you put on enough ads, you'll be able to sell a couple of thousand of Volts a month, but is that really enough to make the difference at the end of the day? Is this the year when Dan Akerson, the CEO of GM, is going to pull the plug on the Chevy Volt? I need a prediction. Sharon Turlip, right now.
No. There you go. No.
He's not going to do it.
No. I mean, I think, because it's not, I would be surprised if it was that black and white. I think what you'd see with the Volt is, they might downsize it. They might use the technology that's in the Volt in another car. I mean, but it would be, given what they've put into this car, to just say we're done right now is not, I don't think I'd be really, I don't, I, you are, would not going to happen.
Are the current managers and the board members of General Motors eager to see the U.S. Treasury, the U.S. taxpayer, sell their remaining shares? I think they still own about 25% of the shares in General Motors. Are they eager to see that happen as soon as possible?
Yeah, I think eager would be an understatement. Yeah. I mean, they don't.
So why don't they just sell the shares? Why doesn't the Treasury sell the shares?
Well, if you remember, the shares are now trading,
$25
under the $33 that they sold them at. They need to be $53 in order for the government to break. So it's not going to happen. So the government doesn't want to take a bath. They're probably not going to sell under $30. They're kind of waiting for it to break $30.
Right.
The government's not in a huge rush to get out of GM, and GM's not thrilled about that.